This year marks the 100th anniversary of a landmark in Boston politics. It's the legendary mansion on the Jamaica Way that was the home of Boston's four-time mayor, James Michael Curley. The building is legendary for different reasons, whether as a destination for the needy, a mark of aspiration, or flagrant evidence of corruption. But the building and its contents have much to say about a political figure who was both insurgent and imperial, or as one biographer called him, a rascal king. That story figures in a current exhibit at City Hall, based on a project by professors at Wentworth Institute of Technology. We'd like to welcome them, an associate professor in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, Dr. Christopher Gleason, and an assistant professor in Humanities and Social Sciences, Jody Michael Gordon. Thank you both very much for being with us, gentlemen.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
So first of all, let's start with Chris Gleason. This is not so much a political science or history. What kind of course is this?
Yeah, not at all. It's a It's part of a program that we have at Wentworth now called Media Culture and Communication Studies. The course in particular is called Media Culture Communication Studies Studio. So the course in general could be any semester-long project. This particular focus on Curley actually was suggested by students in an intro class where they were doing a proof of concept project. It just kind of took off from there.
Now, these are students, were they mainly interested in Boston politics, Boston history, or was it something else that they were getting at?
No, I mean, actually what had happened was these same students had taken a class with a colleague of ours, Larry Overland, who teaches a Boston Public Works course, which happens to focus a lot on Boston Public Works that were influenced by James Michael Curley. So the students had already learned a bit about Curley through that class. And when they had a chance to do a proof of concept project for a digital humanities project, they suggested this, and it was a good idea. And then when we realized that we might actually be able to get access to the house, we thought it would be a really good idea.
Jody, Curley was a master builder, all kinds of projects, including the old city hospital. But talk about the mansion in the video, because what are we going to learn from looking at this video of the house?
The video of the house is actually, what we see with the video of the house, it's a 3D digital model that was actually put together for us pro bono by Feldman Land Surveyors, who have a pro bono program where they actually try to preserve the existing outline of these major architectural features of the city of Boston, including Symphony Hall and other buildings that that need preservation. So the Curley House in particular seemed to be an excellent project that we could use this technology to make a 3D model of. And what they did basically is brought in a high-tech laser scanner, which makes a digital point cloud of every single piece of the architecture that the laser hits, basically, and reflects back. That information is then processed by a computer and some pretty heavy-duty software, and with that information, we're able to make a literal 3D model of the house. So that not only preserves the building as it stands today in its sort of glory in Boston history, but also gives us this digital model that people can interact with, even if they can't sort of walk in the house on a daily basis, so they see what this house is like that's in their community and is a real part of their history, but gives it a digital angle.
Chris, this is almost a trial run for what we could potentially do by turning this house into something the public could go to, maybe a little bit like a museum. Between the building and the artifacts, what makes this so interesting?
Well, we very much use the house as a kind of model for teaching our students how to curate a humanities project. And so we've always thought of this as being a kind of speculative virtual house museum that we're trying to build. The 3D model is actually somewhat separate. Ideally, we'd like to integrate that model with what we're doing. But we're using another program called Omeka, which is basically a digital exhibit building software and archival software. And so what we've done with the students is each student group, they have to submit a proposal for rooms in the house that they would like to curate. And we've been fortunate enough to be able to bring the students into the house each semester, so they get to see the house, they do some research, and they then get assigned to a room in a group. And that student group then has to come up with a curatorial concept for how they'd like to see that room presented. And they're supposed to try to tie that room into some kind of, you know, historical or cultural context. You know, some of them maybe want to try to recreate the room somewhat authentically. Others might just simply use it as a portal into some other more abstract concept. So it's been a very interesting exercise. And we build upon it each semester so that the next group that comes in actually looks at the previous student work, critiques it, and then builds upon it.
Sure, you know, this house, it's a statement, and maybe a mixed message here, because the first time it was drawn my attention as a kid, oh, look at the shamrocks on the shutters, mm-hmm. but it's in the Georgian Revival style, which itself is a mixed message. It's revolutionary America, but it's also in honor of Imperial Great Britain. So talk about that kind of a mixed message.
Well, this sort of follows what Chris is saying. The house is such a great metaphor for Boston history and the real history of Boston in the 19th and 20th century, because Curley is one of these transitional figures. Curley was someone who grew up in poverty in Roxbury, the son of Irish immigrants who struggled every day to try and make ends meet in a, you know, very difficult housing conditions of that period. And he grew up, you know, basically leaving school early, going and working for a living, doing everything he could, and he was a completely self-made man. He was a real American success story. But the house, I think for him, as soon as he became mayor, one of the first things he did in his first term was start turning ground on this house. And I think that the house really was this victory lap for him. It was this, I finally made it. I finally made it from utter poverty to a level where, you know, we could only dream of that other Bostonians have that live up on Comm Ave or places like this, you know, in that period. And I think that the house was a definite symbol. So you can read the history of 19th and 20th century Boston through that house. It's a portal in that sense.
Chris, when I hear old recordings of Curley, or even when he was mimicked by Billy Bulger at St. Patrick's Day breakfast, you know, the oratory was very high-flown, ornate, and now compare that to later mayors. Johnny Collins, his house, he was in JP a few blocks from here, simple house, Mayor Menino's simple house in Reeville. What's changed since Curley's day?
Oh, well, I think a lot has changed. I'm not sure I want to touch that one, but actually, Jim Vrabel's got a great book that came out recently about the new Boston.
The people's history of
exactly.
Boston.
Exactly. Right? I think Jim provides a good answer to that question. but I know that, you know, Curley, there are lots of stories about how he became such a great orator, right? You know, certainly he was self-educated, spent a lot of time reading, spent a lot of time at the Boston Public Library. There are rumors that he had more formal training in oratory, although there are conflicting
Staley
stories
College
about that.
Staley College of the Spoken Word.
Exactly, mm-hmm. exactly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
But there are conflicting stories about, you know, the extent to which he did that or how often he might have done it. But again, I think it speaks to what Jody was saying, was that, I mean, it's really a remarkable story because he really came from one place in Boston and one sort of station life and really kind of rose up and you know, became mayor of Boston and built this, symbolic house on the Jamaica Way.
How do you connect the dots here? Because you've gone through these ruins and provincial outposts in the Roman Empire and you've seen something similar. What's going on here?
Well, I think Curley, in a lot of ways, one of the first things I said, we had one of the first meetings about what is this project we could put together and this James Michael Curley character. And I have to say, I'm not even a Boston native. I didn't know Curley very well. But when I started to hear the contours of what he had achieved, I mean, being mayor four times against all odds, even when they had passed laws for him to be reelected in this period, which is why there's 4 years every time between his times in power, he was really, I think, in his own mind, this kind of Augustus-like character. I like to see him like a Roman emperor. It's like I came to the Rome, a city of brick, and left it a city of marble. And I think Curley had a similar view. There's a famous quote, you know, that he had where he said, you know, where I found a place where people couldn't even afford, you know, the basic medicine, I built a hospital. And when I found a place that was, you know, a rundown part of the city, I made a park. You know, he really had that kind of Augustan view of the city that he was, I don't want to say an emperor. I'm sure he thought of himself very highly, but he did find that he had a profound ability to change things. And I think through public works especially, that's one of the ways we see Curley's imprint on the city. You'll go by different monuments in the common or even crossover bridges and things like this, and they have Curley's name on them. And the L Street Bathhouse in Southie, for example, these are places that will always be associated with Curley, and he saw himself as a builder, so that's definitely a part of his personality.
Thank you both very much, Jody Michael Gordon and Chris Gleason from Wentworth Institute of Technology. We'll have more news in just a moment.